Well, keep in mind for Nietzsche, the Übermensch, or the overman, the superman, was a very rare individual. This is the person who exercises, one of the key phrases for Nietzsche was this idea of a will to power. And the will to power is the ability to know that there's nothing, the ability to know there's no foundation, and then to choose a reality anyway, and then to assert that that is true and to make it so. And then to be courageous enough even to invite others along to do that. That's what the Übermensch does. And if you want an example of what an Übermensch looks like in action, it's Adolf Hitler. Because Hitler fancied himself as an Übermensch. He's the one strong enough to say, this is it, this is what's real, and I'm going to make it so, and everybody went on board with it. That's what it looks like. But those people are rare. Most people can't handle the pressure of being an Übermensch. They can't deal with it. They don't have that courage, that will to power. So what Nietzsche said is what most people do is they just fall back into the herd. And that was his dismissive, you know, just kind of everybody, it's just herd. And so you just kind of go along with everybody else in the flock. You do what you're supposed to do. You're just part of the herd. And you mindlessly, stupidly do what everybody else is doing without giving it any thought. That's the herd. And think about America today. Yeah, there are a few herd people around. And, you know, just kind of, this is what you're fed to do. You do it, and you just kind of go with it. And you think even about how people go through their daily lives. You know, the routines of work, and then run the kids to all these activities, and then have the great vacation and the exciting nights out. Why are they doing all this stuff? Most people never choose any of it. They just accept it and just go with it. And if you ever sit down and ask them, why are you doing that with your kids? They don't have answers. They don't have a clue. They're just doing it because that's what you do. And the best they can give is, well, I want my kid to have this experience so we can get a great scholarship, so we can go to a really good school, so we can make lots of money and be happy. And is that the goal? And for a lot of people, it is. And that's, frankly, pathetic. But that's where we are as a culture. So, anyway, I just wanted to pick that loose end up. Now, I told you, and by the way, my apologies for running into lunchtime. I was going by that clock, which I found out is about 5 minutes slow, which is perfect when you're ending. I got five more minutes. I'll just roll. So I will try to get you out of here on time because I'm a stickler for time. You guys, whoever had me in class knows that. I hate running over. When I was a student, I hated when a prof would go over time. It's like, I endured to this moment. Don't make me go a minute longer. And it's a pet peeve of mine. I just hate it. So my apologies for running over into your lunchtime. That was inappropriate. So I will try to remember that when I wrap up this time. Now, I told you, though, the first half, my hour this morning, was the American individual. And I made my case, and a lot of you didn't like it. I knew that, and I heard it plenty up here. And understand this as well. I am giving you the short shrift version, horribly oversimplified, and it's not that simple. Things are far more complicated when it comes to the politics, America's founding. Yes, there were Christians there. I know Dan Barton. Don't worry. Don't send me any Barton links. I've read him. I know his stuff. I know about it. I disagree. Okay? So you're not going to convince me by sending me more Barton junk. Yes, there were Christians involved. Yes, they had a role. And the role was primarily moral training so that we don't have people going off the rails. And so we need to keep some check. And so the church had a role. That's what Reef is saying. Church had a role. Now we've lost that. Look where we are. Now, everything is much more complicated. And one of the things I have learned and paying more attention to lately as my years in the academy is nothing is ever as simple as you think it is. We have these good friends my wife and I hang out with. One of them's M.D. And one of the other gals is always asking him, now I had this happen. Is this what's going on? And he's like, sure. You know, if you want to think that it's just that simple, that's fine. It is, but the reality, of course, is it's far more complicated, and I can't explain it to you because you won't get it, but fine, that's enough. And that's how it is often. But one of the things I've learned also in the academy is we cheat all the time by oversimplifying. We create paradigms, we create forms, we create categories, and we slot people in, and people always say, that's not fair. Well, of course it's not, but how else are you going to learn? And so the academy oversimplifies for the sake of learning, so that you can learn, okay, that's how it works, and now you realize it's not that simple. So just take that with a grain of salt. Everything I'm telling you today, everything is far more complicated. You start digging into stuff, there's all kinds of other stuff on top, and all kinds of other things going on. It's not as simple as I'm making it sound, but you've got to start somewhere, and in the academy, that's kind of what we do. We try to make things accessible. And in the process, yeah, you get oversimplified. And when people say, that's not how it is, it's like, yeah, duh, we know that, but how else are we going to get it across? So anyway, I just wanted to say that because I'm trying to cover my tail. All right. That's important in the academy, too. I've learned that. All right. So this morning was the American individual. What I want to do now is I want to talk about the Christian individual. And what has prompted this is my thinking over the years, and I've come to really detest this individualism and really loathe it. And the individual is God, and I see the damage it does. I see the damage it does in congregations. I see the damage it does in families. I see the damage it does in society. It's horrendous. And the reality we need to recognize and be honest about is how that individualism creeps into our own lives, our own families, our own congregations. We play right into this, guys. It's just part of the air around us. The culture is not just out there. We're a culture. We're part of it. And it's in us, too. And we need to recognize that. And it doesn't mean, like, I have to repent of everything. Well, repentance is always good. But you're just part of this thing. This American culture is our world. And we have to recognize that and be aware of it. So I don't like the individualism. I think it's hugely problematic. And it shows up all over the place. It shows up when you've got these idiot parents who say, well, I don't want to force my children to believe anything. It's going to be their choice to decide when they get older. You know, that's just stupid as heck. Hauerwas, something else he wrote just recently, just nails it. He said, all that is admitting you're afraid to teach them what you believe. It's cowardice. And if you don't believe what you're believing strong enough to teach it to your kids, why are you believing it? And that's just brilliant on his part, I think. And so if we hold something to be true, teach your kids. Is that called indoctrination? Yeah, I'm all over it. I'm a big fan of brainwashing. I love it. I try to brainwash my students all the time. I'm trying to indoctrinate you. I get 2 hours. It's not much, but I'm trying. And so I want you to think a certain way. That's exactly what we do. And in the church, we're all over that. So don't be ashamed of that. That's what we're trying to do. We're trying to form people into a life, which I'll get to a little bit more later on here. All right. So this Christian individualism. As much as I hate individualism, I was reflecting on this and your topic and what I was going to say, and it hit me. And this kind of gets to the titles I did give you, which I will get to eventually here. And it hit me that, individualism is not all bad. And we need to recognize that. And as much as I push against individualism and all the horrors that go with it and the need for a community that becomes formative and normative and habituates us into ways of life, as much as I'm a huge fan of that and trying to teach that, individuals are what God created. And there's a place to be thinking about individuals. And where this really hit me was when I heard somebody recently introducing himself. And this is a fine introduction because it's making a point. And the person said, who are you? I said, well, first I want you to know I'm a baptized child of God. That's my identity. I thought, that's cool. We all think, oh, that's awesome. AC4 stuff, he's just owning it. That's great. That's awesome. But I thought, okay, that's fine. That's not really your identity entirely. Because you see, we don't get baptized and just become this kind of generic Christian. We all know better than that. That's why we fight all the time. Because we're different. And that's why we argue about worship style and confessional and all these other things. Because we're different. And we have a common identity, but we're not stamped out of a machine. And individualism is a evil, but being an individual is God's plan. And so I want to actually retrieve this a little bit and bring up a whole other side to this of the individual as what God has actually made. And so what I want you to begin to think about is how the individual that you are is part of God's plan. And what's really awesome about Christianity is we don't level everything down to being just homogeneous all the same. The beautiful thing about Christianity is that God takes all of these individuals that are all so very different and he puts them together in this thing called the body of Christ. And now we have this thing that holds us together, which is our common confession and our common Lord, but we're all over the place as individuals. And it's always been that way, and it's God's plan. So I want to be careful that we don't start thinking that, you know, my baptismal identity, that's who I am, child of God. And I've been hearing this kind of move of, well, the problem with the culture is they think your identity is in your sexuality, and that's the problem. Now, the reality is your identity is in your baptism. And I don't think that's that helpful, frankly. I just don't. Because to say that it's either sexuality or baptism is missing the point. Because your individuality is very sexual. It just is. I mean, part of who you are is the sex that God gave you. And whether you're male or female, it's what God made you, and it's core to who you are. We know that. And so sexuality is not incidental, and sexuality is not the problem. So people arguing about, well, my sexual identity, that's not really the problem. The problem is not having something greater outside of that to ground and direct and feed who you are. That becomes the bigger issue. So I don't think we should be railing against sexual identity versus baptismal identity. For me, as a Christian, they're all true. I'm a God's baptized child, I'm a male, and I'm going to be a male for eternity, frankly. And that's something we know, we confess, but we don't think about very much. And I'll get a little bit to the eschatological stuff before I'm all done here. It's my plan anyway. We'll see how things go. So I want us to think a little bit more about just the biblical side of this, the confessional Lutheran side of this. And so let's start, and I'm going to actually do something strange for a systematician. We're going to look at the Bible. I know it's an old joke, but it always works. Because we know there's truth in it. It's just horrible, but sometimes it's not time to look at the Bible. You just got to teach instead. So we're going to take a look at the Bible. And I don't have this text up here because if I opened the text and started looking at it, we wouldn't get past it. But in Genesis 1 and 2, what we need to keep in mind is these are the creation accounts. Obviously, we all know this. We've got these twin creation accounts, very different from each other, complementary. How we complement them and how we hold them together, I'm more and more perplexed by that, but I'm not having a problem with it because God tells us truth, it's all true. But it's really interesting when you start looking at it, the creation accounts. And as I said, we could spend a long time. I am increasingly intrigued at how important the creation account is for our understanding of anthropology, who we are, our purpose in life, vocation. All that is all right there in those creation accounts. But think about the second creation account. It starts in Genesis 2:4, or 5, somewhere in there, very beginning of chapter 2, where the second creation account starts, which would be traditionally the Yahwist one, but we won't go there. And so this is the story being told about Adam's creation, and this is the much more anthropologic kind of story. It starts with Adam. What's fascinating, and this only hit me just recently, and it's not relevant, but I got to say this because it just hit me, and it blew me away when I realized this. When you read Genesis 2, the second creation account, it says, now there was a mist that would rise up, and there was nothing, as yet not anything, no plant in the field. So there was something, but it wasn't organized. It was kind of just this stuff, and a mist would rise up. And then God said, so in the very first thing God does is what? He goes down to the mud that's there, and what's he do? He builds a man. He builds Adam from the mud. And so he takes the mud, the Adama, and he makes an Adam from it. So you get the mud man up out of the dirt, and there he is, Adam. So the very first thing God creates in Genesis 2 is Adam. Now, I know, don't even try to figure out how to fit it with Genesis 1. Just live with it. It's the very first thing he creates in Genesis 2 is the beautiful poetry. There's Adam, and he exists. And then, read the text if you doubt me, then he plants a garden in Eden, and all the plants are there, and he puts Adam there to take care of it, to till it. So that's his vocation. There you go, Adam, take care of it. And then God says, oh, wait, he's all alone. Not cool. We got to do something about that. So what does God get busy doing? Creating all the stuff. And so all the animals are created. Why? For Adam's benefit. Looking for the appropriate helper for him. And so then we get all the parade of the animals, and this is where you cue Bob Dylan, God gave name to all the animals. Anybody with me on that? Oh, only two of you? Oh. So it's when I need to have it on my iPad, just, you know, cue it up, you get the reggae beat. God, just check it out. Bob Dylan, God, man gave name to all the animals. Check it out. Trust me on this one. All right. So man starts naming them all. Giraffe, zebra, dog. Dogs are pretty cool. Man's best friend, but not quite what I need. Chimps, that's interesting. Close, but not quite. And so all the animals get their name. And then when we're all done with the all the animal parade, what is the realization? Nope, not there. So then what does God do? Deep sleep comes on Adam. He falls asleep, and he pulls out the side of Adam, crafts, new verb, a woman, and brings her to the man, and he's like, yeah, cool. And now we're done. Now it's all very good. So what's the first thing created in Genesis 2? Man. What's the last thing created in Genesis 2? Woman. Isn't that awesome? Blew me away when I saw that. It's just so awesome. It's these beautiful bookends. And it's been there my whole life. I just never paid attention. So there you have it. So man is created, and then woman is created, and everything else is in between. They are the ones who are taking care of it all. The stewards. It's their baby. Watch over this. It's yours to take care of, and you're the bookends of the whole creation. It's just delicious and beautiful and wonderful. And it has so much to say about what it means to be human, what it means to be in the world, what we're doing. Now, keep this in mind. When God creates Adam and builds him, does he build a generic man who is like every man in his in toto right there? No. He builds Adam, who's an Adam. And someday, at the eschaton, when we're all resurrected, will Adam be there? Yeah. With a body. The Adam body. And like, cool. Good to meet you, Adam. Oh, you're blonde. No, actually, you're curly-haired black hair. You know, whatever it is. But he's going to be a guy with a literal body and characteristics that are all his, because he's not some kind of generic man. He's a man. And Eve, when she's created, is a real woman with unique DNA, unique characteristics. She is who she is, a unique creation of God. She is an individual. And that's the biblical basis for this individuality that we need to think about, that God does not create just generic cookie-cutter things. Everyone's unique. You can't even do a Care Bear as well as God can do this. You know, all the individual characteristics. No, it's infinite what can happen, because God takes every single person and crafts it, and we get this conglomeration of the DNA and another unique individual. And yet we're all human, but we're all individuals. Even Jesus is not some sort of generic human. He is Jesus of Nazareth, son of Mary. So he's got real human DNA. He has to, or he wouldn't be human. So he's got unique DNA, different from yours, and yet he is the perfect human, the perfect man. We all know this, but he is an individual as well. Every human, by virtue of being human, has unique individual DNA. And I'll say this now in case I forget, because I was reflecting on this. And even if, theoretically, there was someone out there with the identical DNA you've got, identical twins or whatever, you're still not the same, because our environment comes into play, and we have all these different factors that shape us, the people we hang out with, the things we do, the experiences we have, and that becomes part of who we are as well. And that's an important part of where I want to go with all this. All right, now, so that's the Genesis 1 and 2 kind of basic foundation underneath things. Now, I, in preparation for this, I did my extensive research, which has meant I went to Bible Gateway and typed in individual and saw what I got. You know, that's how systematicians do exegesis. And then I did the same thing with identity. And I use the New American Standard Bible, kind of my favorite English translation, because I, way back in my Ann Arbor days, when we were learning Greek from Jacob Heckert, quickly realized the New American Standard is almost word for word with the Nestle Aland, so it was the perfect check your Greek text, and so that's why I started using it, and I've never really gone back. So anyway, in the New American Standard, the word identity, guess how many times it shows up in the Bible? Zero. The word identity is not in the Bible. Individual. New American Standard, individual or a form thereof, 6 times. That's it. And it translates different Greek words almost every time. There's no straight-up Greek word for individual, which is not a shock, because that's not how their world worked, and it's not how the biblical world worked. And yet there is a sense that comes through here. So one of the first things I want to get at, and this is a text with no word of individual in it, but it's a great text for thinking about this. Psalm 139. We're all familiar with this. This is the great text that encourages us with God's nearness and how we're all part of his reality, and he knows everything about us. So just verses 13 to 16. For you formed my inward parts. You wove me in my mother's womb. I will give thanks to you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the depths of the earth. And it's a weird thought there that somehow his body was being formed in the guts of the earth and then brought into the womb to be born. But we don't need to get into all that. And it ties into this connection to the earth again. Your eyes have seen my unformed substance, and in your book were written all the days that were ordained for me, when as yet there was not one of them. Now, why is this such a great text? Because here you have the psalmist saying, you knew everything about me. You put me together. You wove me together in my mother's womb. I am the way I am because of your choice. So every single one of us has an individuality given to us by God. And you want to talk about self-esteem, you know, all this self-esteem nonsense from psychology, we've got all we need right there. God made you the way you are because that's what he wanted. And so whatever you hate about yourself, talk to God about it. It was his plan. And you are what you are because of his plan. So my frame was hidden to you, it was built together in the hidden places. And then here's the other aspect of this. And the days ordained for me, all of them you knew. And so you see, that gets the other part of what I was getting at. So your individuality, yep, it's your DNA, it's how you were woven together, but it's all the days too. All the days of my life. You knew them all. You knew who mom and dad were going to be. You knew who my best friend was going to be in sixth grade. You knew who I was going to hang out with in high school and get into trouble with. You knew who I was going to date and dump and who dumped me. You knew all of it. All those formative experiences, all those things that impacted me and shaped me and made me who I am. You knew it all. And it was your plan. And I'm the result of all that. That's awesome. And you see, this speaks so loudly to a culture that is desperate to know, what am I doing here? Who am I? Where did I come from? What's the point? And the culture says, it's yours to figure out. Have fun. And people are, I don't want to figure it out. Terrifying. Because it is terrifying. It's too much. And so the biblical world says, here's who you are. I made you. You're the way you are because I chose it. It's my plan. All your experience in life, it's all part of the plan. It's all good. Embrace it and just delight in it. And see, the really beautiful thing about this is when you jump into the biblical confessional world and say, ah, Jesus is Lord, I'm creature, it frees you to now just to delight in all that God gives and all he brings, because you don't have to do this nonsense hard work of trying to create meaning and gin up some significance, because you got it. It's just been handed to you. So that's all going on there in Psalm 139. He made you. He gave you your days. It's all part of the plan. It's powerful, beautiful stuff. All right, then we jump to Romans. And here's where the first time we actually get the word individual, at least in New American Standard. And I'm using the 95 version. There's a newer version around that did the gender language and, you know, put through sisters all over the place. So you got brother and sister now. So I like 95. For just as we have many members in one body and all the members do not have the same function, so we who are many are one body in Christ, and individually members of one another. That's the biblical theme again and again and again. Oneness in Christ, one body, we are in the body of Christ, there it is, and yet individually members of it. And of course, Paul runs rampant with this imagery in 1 Corinthians, the whole body, all of its many parts, foot, ear, eye, and all the different parts of the body, yet coming together for one body. Now, the Greek gives us this classic thing here. So, de kath heis alelon mele. So, one of the other's parts. So, one part of the others. And that's the closest we get to individual. So, you're one of all the others, one part of the body of Christ. And so, we have this esmen, soma esmen, the body. We are the body in Christ, one body, but we are one of the parts, the many parts together. So that's the closest we get to the idea of individual. You're an individual, but by virtue of your creation and your life and where God situates you, you're always enmeshed in these relationships. You're part of something else, a family, a church, a body. You're connected, and that's the way God works it. Individuals connected. And that's going to be the recurrent theme. Not a leveling that we're all the same, just cogs in a machine, as Marx would have it, and how, well, not Marx, but more like Lenin and Stalin would have it. But no, unique individuals, created to be what we are, and yet living together. All right, so then we go to 1 Corinthians 12. But one and the same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually, just as he wills. And now we get the other way of putting this. So we have the all these things he works in one according to one and the same Spirit, pneuma, so one and the same, auto Spirit, working, giving, delivering to each one according to what he wills. So idea hekasto. That's the closest we're going to get to the individual, each one. And so again, we have the theme. Each one uniquely gifted, uniquely crafted, uniquely designed, fitting into the overplan, and according to whose will? The Spirit's. The Spirit chooses. This is not Nietzsche, will to power, decide who you want to be, decide what you want to be. No, the Spirit speaks it. He delivers it. He says it. And just to stay the obvious, but you see, in the world of this gender fluidity and everybody discovering who they are, what our answer is, no, God told you who you are, and you need to live in conformity with this. And if you feel like you're a woman trapped in a man's body, that's tough. I get that. And I sympathize, and we will be here to help you figure out how to live with that hard reality. But you know, your body is your body. And we need to figure out how we deal with the hardness of this, but we will. And we'll work on this together. And the answer is not to become the woman you were always supposed to be, because you're not supposed to be a woman, or God wouldn't have built you that way. And that's the kind of way we answer this, which might sound harsh and uncaring, but it's the bottom line answer. All right, 1 Corinthians 12, 27, same chapter. Now you are Christ's body and individually members of it. Same thing going on here. We even have the same stuff. But now we go back to the melee ek merus. So the parts of the overall member, the overall thing, the merus. And so we have it kind of fitting in here, the members of the part is literally what we have. And so we have the other way of saying it. So again, there's not one way of doing the individuality. And then Ephesians 4, from the whole body being fitted and held together by what every joint supplies according to the proper working of each individual part, causes the growth of the body for the building of itself up in love. So what we're getting here is this consistent theme of the individual that God has made us. And it's not some sort of just damped out, generic, baptized child of God. That's who I am. That's true. But you are much more than that. You're the son of a certain man and a certain woman. You have these certain friends, these certain relationships. You are a unique individual. And you will be that unique individual for eternity. And that's where 2 Corinthians takes us. So this is a little longer section. Therefore, we do not lose heart. But though our outer man, the flesh, is decaying, yet our inner man is being renewed day by day. And we have to be careful here. This is not necessarily just old man, new man. This here is outer man is really getting at the flesh part. Yeah, that's decaying. It is. But this new man who we are in Christ is being renewed. For momentary light affliction is producing for us an eternal weight of glory. A phrase that C.S. Lewis jumped all over and did marvelous things with. More on Lewis here before we're done. Far beyond all comparison. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal. The things which are not seen are eternal. There's more going on than what we see. For we know that if the earthly tent, which I'm convinced is the human body, our flesh, which is our house, is torn down in death, we have a building from God, a house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. And I'm persuaded, and I'm not alone, that the building from God is the resurrection body. And this is what we're waiting forward to, the house not made with hands. For indeed in this house, my body now, we groan, longing to be clothed with our dwelling from heaven, with the resurrection body, which is not prone to suffering and all the horrors that we endure as humans in a fallen world. Inasmuch as we, having put it on, will not be found naked. Fascinating thought. So you see, a disembodied soul is not quite the way it's supposed to be, is it? And I think that's what Paul means here by being found naked. It's you're caught without your body. It's not quite right. And that's why we look forward to the resurrection of the body. And that's why, this is a whole other topic, but I'll just throw this bomb out there. That's why for the hope of our Christian life, it's not just to die and go to heaven, but it's for the resurrection of the body on the last day. That's what we're aiming for. And that's what Paul is getting at here. And so we're looking forward to being clothed with our heavenly dwelling, our resurrection body. For indeed, while we are in this tent, we groan, being burdened, because we do not want to be unclothed, but to be clothed, so that what is mortal will be swallowed up by life. Now, he who prepared us for this very purpose is God, who gave to us the Spirit as a pledge. So we've got the taste of it now. That's what the church does, the foretaste of what is to come. We're living it now. Therefore, being always of good courage, and knowing that while we are at home in the body, here now, sitting around with our bodies that fall apart and get old and die, we are absent from the Lord, and that makes us long to be with him. For we walk by faith, not by sight. There's a whole lot more coming, we know it. We are of good courage, I say. So in spite of that, good courage. In spite of the junk all around, good courage. And how happy was the culture in which Paul was living? Not a good one. And yet, good courage. We prefer rather to be absent from the body and to be at home with the Lord. And in Philippians, Paul says that's better by far. Right. Therefore, we also have as our ambition, whether at home or absent, to be pleasing to him. For we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ, so that each one may be recompensed for his deeds in the body, according to what he has done, whether good or bad. And that's every Lutheran's favorite verse. No, I'm sorry. We don't like that one there. There. We don't. That's not really in the Bible. We'll just kind of skip that. Now, it's there, obviously. And what do we do with that? Well, what we do with that is our lives matter. What we do as individuals matter. And it all becomes part of our story. Now, this is stuff I've been thinking about for a long time, ever since I did my grad work, is the reality that we are an accumulation of all of the things we work at. My character, my individual personal agency, my individuality is not just what God says about me at my baptism. It's not just what God says to me at the communion rail when he says, forgiven child of God. My individuality is all the stuff in my life. And you know this. You know this. You know that the things that you work at, the musical skills you've acquired through, how did you acquire those? You just pick up the trombone for the first time and got it? I played trombone a long time ago. Is that how it works? No. Every once in a while hear about a prodigy. But most of us, it's long work. You acquire these things. And then you acquire skills as a father or a mother and you raise kids. Do all those things have an impact on you? Do they shape who you are? Absolutely. Absolutely. And so this idea that, no, the real me is not that stuff is just dead wrong. You are the product, the accumulation of all of your entire life. It's all part of who you are. It's your story. And so your wife, your husband, your kids, your friends, the people you hang out with, the people in your congregation, all of them become participants in who you are, and they become part of the individual person you are. So who you are is not just what God says at the font. That gives you the confidence that I am God's child. I know where I fit. I know that I belong. And now I am free to become the individual he created me to be. So when we explore things and learn things and develop gifts and talents, this is all God-pleasing. It's all part of being the individual God made you to be, the unique special person you are. And in your doing that, you strive to do those things well. Because why? God's going to hold you accountable. And I believe he will. I believe the day will come and he'll say, all right, what'd you do with your 80 years or your 90 years or whatever I gave you? What'd you do with your time? Well, I'm a forgiven child of God. Yeah, that's cool. What'd you do? I believe that will happen. I really do. And you might say, well, I'm not judged in my works. No, you're fine. You're a child of God. You're in. You know, that's fine. But what you do matters. And it all becomes part of your story. So let's not forget that individual who we are. Now, that's my stuff I've got from the Bible. Now I also want to look at the catechism. And I found this really fascinating. I didn't put this up here. I don't think I did that. Did I do that? No, I didn't. But if you go to the small catechism and you read Luther talking about baptism, and Luther's section of the baptism is four questions. It's really interesting because he uses we and the person, and it's all kind of vague. It's very general. And so baptism makes you a new, you know, we are baptized, we drown the old man, and we rise up a new man. He just uses these plurals. But in the first when he's doing the creed, he makes a very interesting move. And I didn't notice this until I was kind of paying attention, thinking about this presentation. So look at what Luther does in his explanation to the creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. Was ist das? Answer, I believe that God has created me, together with all that exists, has given me and still preserves my body and soul, eyes, ears, and all limbs and senses, reason and all mental faculties. In addition, daily and abundantly provides. On and on we go. And for this, I owe it to God to praise, serve, and obey him. It's all first person singular. All first person singular. Second article, I believe in Jesus Christ. What does this mean? What is this? Oops, there we go. Froze for a minute. High-tech stuff. All right. What is this? I believe that Jesus Christ, true God, begotten of the Father in eternity, and also a true human being born of the Virgin Mary, is my Lord. He has redeemed me, a lost and condemned person, man. He has purchased and freed me from all sins, from death and the power of the devil, not with gold or silver, but with his holy, precious blood, innocent suffering, and death. And by the way, I pulled this from the Cold Blanket. That's why we're getting the gender-neutral language. Thank you, Fortress. All right. And so, it's all first-person singular. Me. I. This is the pro me that was so important to Luther. God did this for me. Pro me. And that is two words. I know that. So, it's for me that he did this. He claimed me, an individual. It's for me that he did these things. Third article, I believe that by my own understanding or strength, I cannot believe in Jesus, my Lord, but instead the Holy Spirit has called me through the gospel, enlightened me with his gifts, made me and kept me holy in the true faith. This is he calls and gathers the whole Christian church, and now the church comes into play in the third article because he incorporates us into this body of Christ, but he's doing it for me, an individual. There is no confession in the world that takes individuals more seriously than Christianity. And that's what struck me when I was prepping this talk with you guys today. It's just how special the individual is in Christianity. I'd heard this before, but I never thought about how important this is. God doesn't create generic humans. He creates individual humans, every one of us unique. Every one of us special. And the goal is never to try to level everything out, but to accentuate the differentness. That's exactly the image you get at the eschaton, right? Every nation, tribe, tongue, all together, and we're all around the throne together, but we're all different and weird and strange and odd and annoying, and that's what we are. And it's riotously beautiful. That's the kind of picture we get. And the confessions just are spot on with this. All these first-person pronouns, it's phenomenal. It is so cool, the continuity of this. All right, so we got that. We're doing well on time. I was thinking about this whole individuality thing, too, and I was, you know, you've heard this before, probably, that you're not the same person you used to be because everything in your body replaces itself, and so every 7 years you get a whole new you. You've heard this? Well, I looked it up. It's not true. There's a huge replacement. This blew me away because I got curious about this. So in 1 minute, I was doing my checking this. Now I'll do a second, it's easier. So in 1 second, 1 to 5 million cells in your body die. In 1 second, blew me away. I knew it was going to be a lot, but I didn't think it was going to be that many. And so in 1 second, between 1 and 5 million cells in your body dead, and they're replaced with new ones. And so there are some parts of our body that are replacing themselves very quickly, but some cells last for a long time. Tooth enamel does not regenerate. Brain cells don't come back. That's why when you fry them, when you're drinking too much, they're gone. And that's why potheads are potheads. But that's another topic. They just don't come back. You only get one set of them. And bone cells last a long time too. But other cells, like stomach lining cells, they're a day or two, and then they're toast. And so you got to replace them all the time. So we are dynamic individuals, and yet there's a continuity because you know who you are. And that agency, that individual that you are, is the one that God says you are. That's what sets us apart from the world. We're not out trying to craft our own identity. I'm not on a mission to build my individual brand. I don't have to make a name for myself. God has given me a name. He's given me my identity. I'm in Christ. I'm in this family. I'm a Biermann. I'm a professor. I have grandkids. It's who I am. It's my identity. And lots of these layers. I'm a Lutheran confessional Christian. It's my identity. All those things come into play, and you blend them all together, and I'm this unique individual. And so are you. And that's a beautiful, wonderful thing. And like I said, there's no other teaching that accentuates it like Christianity does. And we need to be on this, I think, a little bit more. And teaching this is part of what we also get at in the kind of uniqueness of who we all are in Christ. So, my individuality then all comes into play. Now, what I want to do here, I'm going to do this first, then I'm going to do the other thing. I've always wanted to do this because the marvelous thing is that this individual that I am is who I am forever. It's who I am forever. Because of the resurrection, this is the body I've got. And what God's going to do is he's going to raise this body. Now, it's going to be a cool new body. Don't sweat it if you don't like your body. But it's still your body. And the imagery that Paul uses is like putting a seed in the ground and then this beautiful thing comes out of it. So what's the connection between an acorn and an oak tree? Well, they're the same thing, but they're not. But there's a continuity. And that's the promise we have. So who I am is who I am forever. Nobody gets this quite as beautifully, potently well as C.S. Lewis. And one of my absolute favorite phrases in all of the Lewis corpus is the little section he does in The Great Divorce. And I've always wanted to do this. I'm going to do it. I'm going to read three pages of C.S. Lewis to you. So hang on. Now, I have wanted to do this my whole life, and I just refer to it, and it never does it justice. Because Lewis is best, in my opinion. This is just so good. So, you know the premise of The Great Divorce, right? The Great Divorce. Well, how many of you have read Great Divorce? Oh, good. Lots of you. You're familiar with this. So, sorry. I'm going to do it anyway. So bear with me. So in The Great Divorce, it's a bus ride from hell to heaven. And so you got these ghosts who are getting another shot at it. Smells like purgatory? Yep. Smells that way to me too, but don't worry about it. Leaf by Nigel, how many of you have read that one? Oh, man, that's good too, isn't it? Spot on. That's purgatory in spades, but it's still so good. Just hold your nose and read it. It's so good. That's by Tolkien. Okay, the other one of the Inklings, another one of the Inklings. So anyway, the bus trip to heaven, from hell to heaven, and these ghosts, these spirits from hell are getting another shot at it, chance to get into heaven. And what's fascinating is Lewis tells a story, a lot of them get back on the bus, they'll go back to hell, they don't want to mess with it. But here's the story about my favorite ghost. I saw coming towards us a ghost who carried something on his shoulder. Like all the ghosts, he was unsubstantial. But they differed from one another, as smokes differ. They're individual. Some had been whitish. This one was dark and oily. What sat on his shoulder was a little red lizard, and it was twitching its tail like a whip and whispering things in his ear. As we caught sight of him, he turned his head to the reptile with a snarl of impatience. "Shut up, I tell you," he said. It wagged its tail and continued to whisper to him. He ceased snarling and presently began to smile. Then he turned and started to limp westward, away from the mountains. The mountains are heaven. "Oh, off so soon," said a voice. The speaker was more or less human in shape, but larger than a man and so bright that I could hardly look at him. His presence smote on my eyes and on my body, too, for there was heat coming from him as well as light, like the morning sun at the beginning of a tyrannous summer day. Now, the narrator is somebody who is kind of observing these ghosts. He's not a ghost himself. He's just there getting to watch, a little bit like, you know, Virgil and Dante. "Yes, I'm off," said the ghost. "Thanks for your hospitality, but it's no good, you see. I told this little chap," here he indicated the lizard, "that he'd have to be quiet if he came, which he insisted on doing. Of course, his stuff won't do here. I realize that, but he won't stop. I shall have to go home. Hell is home. Would you like me to make him quiet?" said the flaming spirit, an angel, as I now understood. "Of course I would," said the ghost. "Then I will kill him," said the angel, taking a step forward. "Oh, ah, look out. You're burning me. Keep away," said the ghost, retreating. "Don't you want him killed?" "You didn't say anything about killing him at first. I hardly meant to bother you with anything so drastic as that." "It's the only way," said the angel, whose burning hands were now very close to the lizard. "Shall I kill it?" "Well, that's a further question. I'm quite open to consider it, but it's a new point, isn't it? I mean, for the moment, I was only thinking about silencing it because up here, well, it's so damned embarrassing. May I kill it?" "Well, there's time to discuss that later." "There is no time. May I kill it?" "Please, I never meant to be such a nuisance. Please, really, don't bother. Look, it's gone to sleep of its own accord. I'm sure it'll be all right now. Thanks ever so much. May I kill it? Honestly, I don't think there's the slightest necessity for that. I'm sure I shall be able to keep it in order now. I think the gradual process would be better, far better than killing it. The gradual process is of no use at all. Don't you think so? Well, I'll think over what you've said very carefully. I honestly will. In fact, I'd let you kill it now, but as a matter of fact, I'm not feeling frightfully well today. It would be most silly to do it now. I'd need to be in good health for the operation. Some other day, perhaps. There is no other day. All days are present now. Get back! You're burning me. How can I tell you to kill it? You'd kill me if you did. It is not so. Why? You're hurting me now. I never said it wouldn't hurt you. I said I wouldn't kill you. Oh, I know. You think I'm a coward. But it isn't that. Really, it isn't. I say, let me run back by tonight's bus and get an opinion from my own doctor. I'll come again the first moment I can. This moment contains all moments. Why are you torturing me? You are jeering at me. How can I let you tear me in pieces? If you wanted to help me, why didn't you kill the damned thing without asking me before I knew it? It would all be over by now if you had. I cannot kill it against your will. It is impossible. Have I your permission? The angel's hands were almost closed on the lizard, but not quite. Then the lizard began chattering to the ghost so loud that even I could hear what it was saying. Be careful, it said. He can do what he says. He can kill me. One fatal word from you, and he will. Then you'll be without me forever and ever. It's not natural. How could you live? You'd be only a sort of ghost, not a real man as you are now. He doesn't understand. He's only a cold, bloodless, abstract thing. It may be natural for him, but it isn't for us. Yes, yes, I know there are no real pleasures now, only dreams, but aren't they better than nothing? And I'll be so good. I admit, I've sometimes gone too far in the past, but I promise I won't do it again. I'll give you nothing but really nice dreams, all sweet and fresh and almost innocent. You might say, quite innocent. Have I your permission? Said the angel to the ghost. I know it will kill me. It won't. But supposing it did. You're right. It would be better to be dead than to live with this creature. Then I may? Damn and blast you. Go on, can't you? Get it over. Do what you like, bellowed the ghost, but ended whimpering. God help me. God help me. Next moment, the ghost gave a scream of agony such as I never heard on earth. The burning one closed his crimson grip on the reptile, twisted it while it bit and writhed, and then flung it, broken-backed, on the turf. Ah, that's done for me, gasped the ghost, reeling backwards. For a moment, I could make out nothing distinctly. Then I saw, between me and the nearest bush, unmistakably solid, but growing every moment solider, the upper arm and the shoulder of a man. And then brighter still and stronger, the legs and hands, the neck and golden head materialized while I watched. And if my attention had not wavered, I should have seen the actual completing of a man, an immense man, naked, not much smaller than the angel. What distracted me was the fact that at the same moment, something seemed to be happening to the lizard. At first, I thought the operation had failed. So far from dying, the creature was still struggling and even growing bigger as it struggled. And as it grew, it changed. Its hinder parts grew rounder. The tail, still flickering, became a tail of hair. It flickered between huge and glossy buttocks. Suddenly, I started back, rubbing my eyes. What stood before me was the greatest stallion I have ever seen. Silvery white, but with mane and tail of gold. It was smooth and shining, rippled with swells of flesh and muscle, whinnying and stamping with its hoofs. At each stamp, the land shook and the trees dindled. The new-made man turned and clapped the new horse's neck. It nosed his bright body. Horse and master breathed each into the other's nostrils. The man turned from it, flung himself at the feet of the burning one, and embraced them. When he rose, I thought his face shone with tears. But it may have been only the liquid love and brightness. One cannot distinguish them in that country, which flowed from him. I had not long to think about it. Turning in his seat, he waved a farewell, then nudged the stallion with his heels. They were off, before I knew while it was happening. There was writing, if you like. I came out as quickly as I could from among the bushes to follow them with my eyes, but already they were only like a shooting star far off in the green plain and soon among the foothills and the mountains. Then, still like a star, I saw them winding up, scaling what seemed impossible steeps, and quicker every moment till near the dim brow of the landscape, so high that I must strain my neck to see them. They vanished, bright themselves, into the rose brightness of that everlasting morning. While I still watched, I noticed that the whole plain and forest were shaking with a sound, which in our world would be too large to hear, but there I could take it with joy. I knew it was not the solid people who were singing. It was the voice of that earth, those woods and those waters, a strange, archaic, inorganic noise that came from all directions at once. The nature or arch nature of that land rejoiced to have been once more ridden and therefore consummated in the person of the horse. It sang, "The master says to our master, come up, share my rest and splendor till all natures that were your enemies become slaves to dance before you and backs for you to ride and firmness for your feet to rest on. From beyond all place and time, out of the very place, authority will be given you. The strengths that once opposed your will shall be obedient fire in your blood and heavenly thunder in your voice. Overcome us so overcome we may be ourselves. We desire the beginning of your reign as we desire dawn and dew, wetness at the birth of light. Master, your master has appointed you forever to be our king of justice and our high priest." "You understand all this, my son," said the teacher. "Don't know about all, sir," said I. "Am I right in thinking the lizard really turned into the horse?" "Aye, but it was killed first. You'll not forget that part of the story." "I'll try not to, sir. But does it mean that everything that is in us can go on to the mountains?" "Nothing, not even the best and noblest, can go on as it now is. Nothing. Not even what is lowest and most bestial will not be raised again if it submits to death. It is sown a natural body, it is raised a spiritual body. Flesh and blood cannot come to the mountains, not because they are too rank, but because they are too weak. What is a lizard compared with a stallion? Lust is a poor, weak, whimpering, whispering thing compared with that richness and energy of desire which will arise when lust has been killed." Isn't that awesome? Blows my mind. Because see, what Lewis is suggesting here, not even suggesting, just saying it flat out, that there is nothing in us that God will not transform into who we are. And so what he's getting at is all that individuality that you are, even the things you struggle with, even the things that mark you as one who suffers, a physical deformity, a mental illness, a family situation that is agonizing, a sin that you struggle with forever, all of those things, they're you, and you know it. They are part of your story. They're part of who you are, and you don't renounce them and say, "That's not me," because it is. What you do is you confess and let God kill it, and he will raise it. And all that you are, all the unique individual that you are, all of that is swept up into the resurrection. All of it is swept up into God's plan. The individual you are is not lost, not a bit of it. There's so much comfort here. When you're counseling somebody who is struggling hard with very difficult situations, you don't tell them, "You got to get rid of this, deny this." You tell them to give this to Christ and let him carry this burden with you and let this person know that at the last day, he is going to make all things new, all things. Every single bit of you, none of it's lost. That's radical individuality. And it's crazy cool. Now, you might think, "Well, that's C.S. Lewis. What do you expect from an Anglican? He's not an Orthodox." So we got this little phrase from the small called articles from Luther. "Good works follow such faith, renewal, and forgiveness of sin. And whatever in these works is still sinful or imperfect should not even be counted as sin or imperfection, precisely for the sake of this same Christ. Instead, the human creature should be called and should be completely, completely righteous and holy, according to both the person and his or her works, by the pure grace and mercy that have been poured and spread over us in Christ." That's Luther. Everything is redeemed in Christ, your person and your works. and even the sinful or imperfect is not counted as sin or imperfection when Christ gets a hold of it. All of it is swept up in his grace, and all becomes part of the story of who you are. It's extraordinary. It just blows my mind. It's such a beautiful picture. So I think Lewis is more right than he is wrong. And what it will be at the eschaton, I don't know. But I'm not worried about it at all. And I cannot wait to see how God transforms everything at the resurrection. And all the wild individuality that we all are and all of our crazy differences, it's going to be more accentuated. We're not going to be flattened out into some kind of vanilla beings of the new creation, but we're going to be unique individuals for the rest of creation and rest of eternity. That's awesome. That's the core of the Christian individuality. And it's so superior to any nonsense we have in this world where we're left to be our own gods, left to find our own way, left to find our own individuality. All right, now I've got just a couple minutes left, and I wanted to say a little bit something totally off this topic, even though this one's just beautiful. This gets into, I know I missed the third session yesterday, but I heard about the enchantment stuff, and you know the idea of truth being conveyed through beauty is spot on. And this is something that we as Lutherans are just terrified of, because how do you control that? Oh, you don't. That's the beautiful thing about God. One of the things getting impressed on me by Hauerwas is he loves this phrase about we need to learn to live life out of control. And that means just be a creature. Let God be in charge. And so when God speaks truth through beauty, that's wonderful. And I think that's what he's doing in The Great Divorce. There's something about that narrative that's just powerful beyond the words. And there's truth there. And you can't always pin it all down. You can't be discursive about it. And if you try, you ruin it. You just kind of let it be truth. It's just like when you're singing a hymn, and it's not just the words. It's the melody. It's everything. It's the voice. It's the heat of the person next to you and hearing them and getting a little bit of their spit on you. It's all part of it. And isn't it just like, yes, this is the body of Christ. There's a beauty that is bigger. And that's what's going on here. Now, so anyway, that's all cool. But I want to talk really quickly here about something that came up in a question time. This is far more pedantic, but it needs to be talked about. And that is the relationship between church and world. And this is huge. And we can spend a long time on this, and I have. And this is my shameless plug, just buy my book. All right? So seriously, Holy Citizens, that's what the whole thing is about. And I wrote the book because I was tired of nobody having a good book on the topic. So I wrote it. I think it's good, but nobody else has read it, so who cares? Howard Wash talks about books he writes that fell stillborn from the press. Nobody reads them, and that's just the way it is. You write stuff and nobody cares. So anyway, the interface between church and world. This gets into stuff like left hand, right hand, two kingdoms. I'm not fond of two kingdoms. Some of you who have had me know this. But what we're getting at here is there is an interface between what God is doing in the church and what he's doing in the world. And the key to remember it is that God is in control of both. This is God's world. This is God's creation. It's going to hell in a handbasket, but it's not going to stay there because God's redeeming it. And that's what's so beautiful about that story from The Great Divorce, because who's rejoicing at the rebuilding of the stallion? The world is. The creation is. Nature is. It's celebrating. And what does it say in that prayer? Subdue us so that we may be ridden again. Nature wants the master, which is man, to be submissive to the master God so that nature can be what it's supposed to be. Lewis follows this theme all the way through. It's thick in Chronicles of Narnia. You know, nothing's right in Narnia until the daughters of Eve and sons of Adam are ruling in Narnia. They're meant to be the masters. So this is just thick in Lewis. So the world is God's world. Don't hate it. Don't run from it. Don't reject it. The world opposed to God, yes, that's sin. But the world itself is not an evil place. And the body is not an evil thing. And sex is not a bad thing. These are great gifts of God to be celebrated as God intends. So the world is God's good world. And the church, what are we here for? The church delivers the reality of the gospel, who we are in Christ. Quorum Deo righteousness. Bam, that's what we do. And what does the world do? The world makes sure everything works according to God's will, because that's what the law is, making sure it's all working together. That's what the world is supposed to do. When the world is not doing its job, and when government's not doing its job, what does the church do? The church says, government, knock it off. Do your job. Be submissive to God. Be submissive to God's will. And if the world says, take a flying leap, we keep telling them. And the world says, shut up, and starts killing us, we keep telling them. And when they throw us into prison, we keep telling them, because that's who we are. We're the church. And if we get kicked out by the world, so be it. It's not the end of the world. Not the end of us. We're in Christ. So we've got to remember who we are and what we're here for. So we don't build a wall between us. We don't run away from the world. We engage the world, but we engage the world with the truth, which is profoundly true for the world and which is going to transform all the world. We know it, and we live it, and we speak it, and we witness to the world a reality that is far more true, far more profound, and far more freeing and joyful than anything they will ever have. We've got stuff far better than any sports team, any kind of social organization. We've got God's reality, and we need to live that. So what we do in the church is we witness God's truth to the world. Yes, we proclaim Christ with our mouths, and we live out in our families, in our friendships, in our congregations, the reality that we are together in this body of Christ, each one of us a unique individual, striving to be obedient to God's will, living God's way for the sake of the world and honoring God in what we do. And we don't expect the world to fall over itself saying, oh, you guys are so smart. Thanks so much for everything you're sharing with us. But we do it anyway. We keep speaking to it. We do what we can. And if we want to focus our energies anywhere, may I suggest this, that we start focusing on where we have absolute immediate responsibility and control. In your family. Zero in on your kids and your grandkids. Make sure that they are formed in Christ, that they are the individuals God created them to be, striving to be all that God created them to be, and delighting in God's gifts. Focus on your families. Invest, invest, invest in your families. And then make sure your families are fully invested in the congregation. You've got some responsibility there too, guys, and some control, because you're the one who's the shepherd. Take it seriously. Worry about your church. Worry about your families. The nation is going to go where the nation goes. I have little hope of it getting turned around. That's just my pessimistic self. Maybe I'm a realist. You can decide what you think. But we do what we can. We speak to the world. Yes, we vote. Yes, we talk to people. Yes, we try to influence the world. But we're not putting our eggs in that basket, guys. We absolutely can't. We put our effort where we need to, on our families and our congregation. We need to be a community apart without apology so the world sees what it looks like when people follow God and honor Him. That's what we're about. I'm out of time. Thank you for your attention.